You nervous?
For you? For your test?
No. I was terrified.
The only way our society can survive is for each of you to claim your rightful place. Today, you will take a test that will help you discover who you truly are. The future belongs to those who know where they belong.
You ready?
This isn't real.
Your results were inconclusive.
This was supposed to tell me what to do. We're supposed to trust the test.
The test didn't work on you. They call it divergent. You can't let them find out about you. They're always watching. You have to hide, or they'd never expect to find you.
Welcome to the illness.
The two stages of training. The first is physical. Push your bodies to the breaking point.
You're never gonna win, not like that.
It's good to know.
Keep tension here, okay?
The second is mental. Face your worst fears and conquer them.
You made a mistake choosing Dauntless. We'll find out about you.
I know what you are. It's been a long time since I could trust anyone. I don't want to be just one thing. I want to be brave and selfless and intelligent and honest and kind. If you want to survive, follow me.
Divergents threaten the system. It won't be safe until they're removed.
We have to fight back.
Ready.
Well, good morning, that church. How's everybody? All right. Now, y'all got to sleep in, so y'all should be peppier than that. Just have a little more something. Those of you joining us online, we're glad you're with us as well. And I want to welcome you to At the Movies. This is a message series that we've done for several years. In fact, we didn't do it last year, though. And we do it, you know, once a year, and we'll take some of the major motion pictures, and we'll try to help you understand some biblical implications of those movies. And so I'm kind of excited about it today, especially. I really, really enjoyed being able to put something together to deal with Divergent. How many of you have seen the movie Divergent? How many of you have seen it? What's the sequel to it? Does anybody know? Insurgent. You hear the little voices. It's Insurgent. I love it. It's the best ever. Yeah. So anyway, yeah. So we got Insurgent and Divergent, and it's a pretty cool movie. It's kind of a neat. I actually like it. Not necessarily the acting part, but I do like sort of the theme. And here's the theme of Divergent. Divergent is a community of people where there's an incredible amount of pressure for everybody to fall into one of five categories. And these categories of people, they call them factions. And so you find your category of people, you reach a certain age of maturity, and it probably tells you when that is, but I don't know when it is. But you reach a certain age, and you take this psychological exam where you take these drugs, and you fall into this trance kind of thing. And out of this test, they're supposed to tell you where it is that you fit into one of those five categories. And community has picked one of five categories. If you don't fit into one of those five categories, or you don't make it in one of those five categories, are factions, you're known as factionless. That means you're kind of homeless, you're out in the streets, you don't get the privileges. But if you do fall into one of those, you pretty much don't have any connection with anybody else, just your little faction. There's so much relevant to this movie. I could have gone in so many different angles. It's pretty amazing. Anyway, the sort of the key lady that's in this show, her name's Beatrice, later changes her name to Tris. Tris is, when she takes the actual test, she's found to be divergent, meaning that she has all or none. She could be in any of those categories or none of those categories. She can choose where her identity would come from. And so think about it from this perspective. Beatrice, in fact, has the opportunity to either take the identity that the world is going to give her, one of these five identities, or she can take another identity and find it from another source. Are you getting right? That'll preach right there, all right? Now, we don't have to go any further. Y'all know where I'm going. Just took away all the suspense. Well, these five categories that they have in this community are basically this. Erudite, and I'm going to have to read it because I'm not like totally up on it. Erudite stands for intelligence. It's the smartest, most logical thinking people. They dress in dark shades of blue. Another category is amity. Amity, as you know, means kindness. And these are people who focus on kind, peaceful living. They grow crops for all the other factions. And they dress in orange and yellow. Then there's candor. They really, you know, lean into honesty. They believe that's really important. They dress in black and white. Go figure. And then there's dauntless. This is the brave group. They're the protectors of the community, and they're also a little reckless and kind of crazy. They dress in all black, sort of, I think, like superhero kind of outfit kind of deals. Then there's abnegation. These are the selfless ones. They take care of the factionless, which are kind of like the homeless in their community. They dress in gray. They're also nicknamed stiffs. And so these are the categories, and you have to fall into one of these categories. And in this community, and I know this is crazy because it's so foreign to us, if you don't fall into one of their categories, you're kind of punished in the community for not fitting into the category. I'm just going to leave you with that. That's so profound because I see that really where we are too. And so what I want to say is this, as it was in Divergent in the movie, we have one of two choices. We can either let the world issue our identity in one of its categories, or we're going to find our identity somewhere else. And I would say the majority of us in this room, I'm not going to say everybody because I'm not speaking for everybody, but I'm going to say the majority of us in this room would say, you are in the category as a follower of Jesus. Now, according to Scripture, if I'm a follower of Jesus, then my identity doesn't come from the world, but my identity comes from Him. And so we're going to look at the fact that God... Get ready, we're going to get to be a superhero in the movie. God's called us to be divergent, all right? In a lot of ways, God's calling you to be different. He's saying, don't find your identity. The only person or the only one who has the right to give you an identity is Jesus Himself. He's the only one that's trustworthy to give you identity. He's the only one. So you're going to have to diverge because in our community also has an agenda. Maybe the categories are not quite as simple or as clean cut as they were in Divergent, but I will say this. The world certainly has an identity that they expect you to take up. And In fact, I would say over the last several weeks, I've never seen so much pressure for people to take sides and take a position and find your place. You know, there are things that we weren't even arguing about that somehow have been brought up, and now we're arguing about them. They weren't even an issue. And all of a sudden, now we've got these issues, and you got to find a side, and you got to take a place. And so how do we deal with that as followers of Jesus? Well, I think by large measure, God's calling you to be divergent. He's calling you to not think within the box, but think within the context of who He's called you to be and who you are in Christ. And we're going to talk about that today. So I'm going to ask one simple question, and this question is going to be something that's going to bring us through the message, and I'll ask it again at the very end of the message. So here's my question. Does your life look more like the world, or does your life look more like Jesus? I'm going to ask two questions. Does your life look more like the world? Does it look more like Jesus? Or does your life look more like religion? Or does it look more like Jesus? And I just want you to think about that. Because here's what I'm going to say. I think for some of us, when we start inventorying our lives, we're going to go, I'm kind of disappointed. Because we're going to find that maybe we don't look so much like Jesus. We look a lot more like the world we live in. Or maybe we don't really look like we came out of the Bible. Maybe we look like we came out of the Bible Belt. And I think that God is calling you to be divergent. You know what? Every group of people wants to put us in a category, don't they? If you're religious, you've got one category. If you're in the world, you're in this supposed to be in this category. But what is the category that Jesus has called you and I to occupy? And I think if we can discover that and look at that and see where our life is in relation to that, I think we can make some adjustments and maybe live the life of faith that we were designed to live in the first place. And so I would say that for the most part, we're probably not diverging very much. I think for some of us, we'd be a little disappointed. I'm a little disappointed because we kind of want to fit in. Matter of fact, let me give you a verse of Scripture, and I want to kind of show you the kind of people that God's calling us to be. This is not in your outline, but it would be in your Bible or in your, you know, YouVersion app or whatever. But it'll also be on the screen, and it's found in 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, it's the second half of verse 8, and I want to just kind of read this to you. And listen to what it says. It says, they stumble because they do not obey God's word, so they meet the faith that was planned for them. Verse 9, listen to this. But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You are a royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. In other words, here's the issue. Here's where it really boils down. God's saying, hey, look, I've called you to be different. That's what the word divergent means, incidentally, is to be different. You are not supposed to look like the rest of the world. You're not supposed to look like religion. You're supposed to look like Christ. And let me tell you something, that's going to be very foreign to the world that we live in. Very foreign. But here's the problem. All of us have wanted to fit in, haven't we? I mean, I remember all the way back to the playground when I was a little kid at Oak Grove Elementary School, I wanted to fit in. I mean, I didn't want to be the one kid out, did you? Heck no. Let me just tell you something. Embarrassingly enough, as I think about it now, and I look back on it, and I'm so regretful of this, but there were times I went with the crowd. I went with the side that was going to win instead of being on the side that should have won. There were times when I was in school as a kid that some kids were being talked about, even bullied, and you know what I didn't do? I didn't stand up for that kid, not all the time. And there were times that I would be with the crowd. I wouldn't necessarily throw in rocks or the one that was, you know, saying the things that were being said, but I didn't say anything to stop it. You want to know why? Because I wanted to fit in. I didn't want to be that one person out. Nobody does, do they? Who wants to be the last person picked on kickball? Nobody. Nobody. You're that last person. You're like, yeah, we'll take Scott. Your self-esteem shot. Sixth grade, you're needing medicine just to get through the day, right? We want to fit in. You know what? Wouldn't it be something if it stopped in elementary school? But it didn't, did it? It's still going on today. We still want to fit in. If your neighbors get something, you want something. If a relative gets something, your house has to be a certain square footage. You got to have a certain size car. And boy, we want to fit in. We have this desire to look like everybody else. And we want to be accepted. And we want to fit in. And so we have a real problem. Let me give you some reasons why I don't think that we're diverging or being different as Christ called us to be. Let me give you two things in particular. Number one is we have a desire to please people. I want to make people. I want to fit in. I want to just fit in with the group. I want to go along with other people. I don't want to be the one person standing out, right? Matter of fact, that's exactly, Saul is a king. He's the king over Israel. Samuel is the spokesman for God. He's the prophet. And you're about to see something cool happen in these guys' relationship. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 24, it says, then Saul said to Samuel, so the king speaks to the guy that's speaking for God. He says, I have sinned. Here's what happened. Samuel had given Saul God's word. He said, there's something God wants you to do, and you do it this way. And I'm going to tell you what that is here in a minute, but I don't want to tell it to you yet, okay? And he says, here's what you're supposed to do. And Saul went, and he didn't do it. He didn't do what he should have done. And here's the reason why. Saul said, I've sinned. I violated God's commands and your instructions. I was afraid of who? You ever been afraid of people? You ain't got to raise your hand. Who honestly, though, has just been in a place where you're like, you know what? I don't want to go against all these people. And you just go along with it. I think all of us could say there's times where we were intimidated, where we were peer pressured, and we did something. We look back on it and you go, you were an idiot. What was wrong with you? Why didn't you do the heroic thing? You know why you didn't? Because at that moment, you wanted to fit in. And it's something natural with us. This package comes natural with this desire to fit in, and that comes natural. And you're going to see that God is going to call you to something more than what you come with naturally. He's going to call you to something supernatural, and he's going to call you not necessarily to fit in. Okay, he's going to call you to be a divergent. And Saul says, you know what? I was afraid of the people, so I gave in to them. I gave in to them. That's what I did. Now, I want to tell you something. God has asked Saul to do something really hard. The thing that Saul didn't do, can I tell you what it was? Here's what it was. There was a group of people known as the Amalekites. Amalekites, all right? And the Amalekites, they were the enemies of the Hebrew people. And God said, you know what? It's time for us to take care of these Amalekites. We got to get rid of them. We got to wipe them out. This is God said this, okay? God said it. He said, so you go in and you annihilate all of them. You kill everybody. The Bible is very specific. God said you kill men, women, boys, girls, everything. You annihilate the whole place and you kill all the animals, especially the cats. It didn't say that part, but he did say kill everything. He did really say that. That's actually true. Just want to see if you're watching here, you know, come on. So he said, kill everything, everything and everybody. Now, I want to stop that for a second because you know what? There are times when you and I are making arguments, whether it's virally or actually, with somebody, and we're trying to prove that our God is a likable God. Because, see, one of the things is this, is not only do you want to be liked, not only do you want to fit in, but you want your God to fit in too, don't we? And so what we constantly are trying to do is we're trying to domesticate God. We're trying to make him fluffy and cuddly like a great blanket. We want God to be lovable and loving. And we want all of that to kind of come together so that people will not only will we fit in, but our God will fit in too. Do you know what I'm talking about? And so we do that a lot lately. And so you'll see people that'll say, God wouldn't do anything like that. He does stuff like this. He's always so easy. He's so loving and kind and gentle. And then this passage of scripture, like with Saul, where God says, you go kill everybody. And then you go, because your enemies will quote the scripture because they actually know the Bible better than we do most of the time. And they'll go, yeah, but what about this passage? Your loving, cuddly God said, go kill everybody. All you animal people, all the animals, he said, to kill them too. Some of you are like, that's it, I'm giving up on it. I've read testimonies of people said, I believed in God till I really started reading the Bible. No, let me tell you what actually happened. You didn't actually believe in God in the beginning. You made a God for yourself. And when you found out that the God that you had created for yourself was not the same God of the Bible, you stopped believing the God of the Bible and you hung on to the God that you'd created for yourself. See, that's where we get into trouble. Yeah, let me give you a passage of scripture. And this is one that I think you want to carry with you. And it's found in Isaiah chapter 55. It's not in your outline. This occurred to me later. Okay, so just work with me. Isaiah 55 and verse 6. You're going to see it right here. And if you want to write this down, I'm going to encourage you to. Isaiah 55, 6 says, seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him now while he's near. And let's just focus on the first word that's in this passage, all right? And that first word is what? Seek. You know what that says? That says that you have to discover God. One of the problems with those of us, even those of us who are in religious circles or those of us who claim to be followers of Jesus, one of our problems is we don't actually seek God. See, the main practice in seeking God would be discovery. But what we sometimes do is we design God. We don't discover God for who he is. We design the God that we want him to be. And let me just say this to you. Of all the things you can do with your life, that is one of the most dangerous things that you can do. The worst thing you can do is set up for yourself a God that fits your life. A God that is fitting to our community. A God that is palatable. God does not want to be designed. He wants to be discovered. And he says, you seek the Lord. You look for me. You put your energy and effort in discovering who God is. And that's what we're supposed to do. He says, you seek me. Now let me tell you why. If you go down to verse 8, here's the reason why you need to seek the Lord. Here's what it says, verse 8. He says, for my thoughts are nothing like your thoughts. Why do we need to discover God for who he is? You want to know why? Because he don't think like you think. See, the God that you're going to design, the idol that you're going to manufacture, he's not going to think like God thinks because you don't think like God thinks. I don't think like God thinks. God thinks differently than I do. God has different ideas than I have. When God sent Saul to destroy the Amalekites, he said, I want rid of these people, destroy everything. I wouldn't have thought to do that. That would have bothered me. I'd been like, no. And Saul didn't like it either. He's like, it's a bad idea. They've got all these goats and they're fat and they would be so good to eat. They'd be so tender. We'll have a barbecue. It'll be awesome. But God says, that's not what I want you to do. This is what I want you to do. But so often, I think we find ourselves in our arrogance and we go, wait a second, God, you can't tell me how to live. God, you can't tell me what to do. Because somehow we think that our justice is above God's justice. Or that our morality is above God's morality. Or our truth is somehow above God's truth. But God wants to remind you, you don't manufacture God for yourself. See, it's no different for you to make a God for yourself than it is the person over there in some foreign country carving some wooden God out or bowing down to a rock or chopping the head off of a chicken or something else. It's the same thing. It's the same sin. It's idolatry. And we do it all the time in the name of church. We created for ourselves a God that's very palatable. We'll say things like this. Well, I wouldn't worship a God if he did what? Something you wouldn't do? Newsflash. You're not God. You don't think like he thinks. Is it possible, just for a moment, think about this. Is it possible that God knows something you don't know? It's very possible, isn't it? I mean, how long have we been here? You've been here, what, 40 years on the planet? 50, 60, 70, 80, some of you, 90? That should cover everybody. 100? Right? You've been here that long, and you have all the infinite wisdom that you think you need to make decisions that will go into eternity? Really? I mean, you really think you do? And so we second-guess God. How can God ask us to do certain things with our lives? How can God tell me how to live? I know how, this is my life. I know how to live. No, the Bible actually teaches if you're a follower of Jesus, it's not your life. It's actually you are not your own, but that you were bought with a price, that you belong to him. And you know what? He knows more than you do. He knows more than I do. I'm not an expert on everything, but God is. And I have to listen to him. You want to know why? Because he knows what's best. Because he don't think like me. And so often, we try to make God think the way we think. See, we want our God to be accepted just like we are. And so we make God into a very palatable, sweet, kind, tooth fairy, Santa Claus, marshmallow man, kind of Keebler elf God. Don't we? Jesus is poetry speaking, sweet, kind, quiet, really, really pale white, long-haired, hippie-fied, girly kind of dude, right? Isn't that what we do? With some sweet tattoo right here that says, I love you, right? That's the God we create. But you know what you could do? You could spend your life, and one of the greatest investments you could give your life to, really, is discovering who God actually is, not who you want him to be. It says this, my thoughts are not like your thoughts, says the Lord. And my ways, what I do, it's not like your ways. It's not like anything you can imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. And my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. I don't think like you do, God says. So before you engage your sensibilities and go, that doesn't make sense that God would say this or that God would do this. Before you do that, don't worry about it making sense. Why don't you just worry about what he said? We want to act on what's true, not act on what we believe is true. What is actually in factory? What did God say? And that's what's really, really important. Let's don't set up an idol for ourselves. Let's see who God is. When I read about the Amalekites, would I have told Saul, go kill everybody? No, I wouldn't have. Do I understand that? I really don't. I really don't. But you know what? There's a lot of things about the Bible. Here's what I found that's funny. I want to reject parts of God that call me to live in a different way than I want to live. But I want to accept the parts of God where I get a real benefit from it. Let me give you an example. I'll say, well, I don't understand how God would say I want all the Amalekites destroyed because he understood something I didn't understand. I want to reject that kind of God and that idea. But what about when my sin fell upon Jesus and killed God's son? And God's son suffered, bled, and died so that I could go free. Let me just tell you something. If it makes sense, that don't make sense. If it's about sensibility, let me tell you, I wouldn't have thought of that. I want to be clear, and I want to tell you, I love you, all of you, most of you. I love you. But I wouldn't think to give my son, I would never even consider it, to give one of my kids up for anybody. I wouldn't have thought like that. But God says, my thoughts aren't like your thoughts. I don't need you to figure me out. I need you to discover who I am. I don't need for you to craft a God for yourself that fits your life or lifestyle or ideas or religion or whatever. I need you to know who I am. That's what I need. And that's what you need, is to discover him. And one of the reasons why I believe we don't live divergently is we have such a deep-seated desire to please people. And that's a problem. Because you can fit in and fit God into things and you lose God in the process. Spend your life discovering who he is. Spend your life seeing what he said. And you want to know the clearest picture of God? It is Jesus. Hebrews 1 says this. And at sundry times and in diverse manners in our past, God spoke to us through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us through his son. You want to know what God looks like? You look at Jesus. You want to know what God would say? You listen to Jesus. You want to know how God wants you to live? You look at Christ and how did he live his life? How did he live? That's where you learn about who God is. All that God wanted you to know about himself is wrapped up in the package of Jesus. And some of us, I think, some of the stories we know them, we're somewhat familiar with the gospel stories. And because we're somewhat familiar with the gospel stories, you know what we think? We think we know God. Listen to me. You could spend the rest of your life and still struggle trying to come to grips with who God actually is. Spend your life discovering him. The Bible speaks over and over of the mystery of God. There's a depth and a width to God that is beyond our comprehension, but that doesn't mean we should stop trying. We need to keep looking and listening and understanding him. It's so important because he wants to be discovered. He wants us to seek him and he wants us to find him. The second thing, the second reason why I believe that we're not diverging is that we can't handle criticism very well. We don't like to be criticized. We like to be liked, right? That's why every social media, all of them have one thing in common. They have this opportunity for someone to like what you're doing because we like to be liked. That's something that really, we get a lot of reward. And you, oh, look at all the likes. I'm liked. Now, let me show you something. That's a like. That's a lot. They didn't really stop for a second and admire you for an extended period of time and go, this person's incredible, before I double tap your picture. Okay? You're not really all that. Okay? Welcome to that church where your self-esteem gets ruined right here. But we like being liked, don't we? So we look at our likes and this person likes me. And when someone doesn't like you, it kind of messes your world up and you can't sleep very good because so-and-so don't like me anymore. Oh, don't like me. And let me read something to you. John chapter 15, verse 18 says, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. All right, let's go further. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not what? You don't belong to the world, but I've chosen you what? Out of the world. Does your life look more like the world? Does it look more like Jesus? Let's move on. That is why the world hates you. If they persecuted me, did they persecute Jesus? That's pretty much recorded history, wouldn't you agree? They killed him. Murdered him on a cross, beat him, spit on him, mocked him, pulled his beard out, punched him in the face, put him on a cross. He didn't have his own tomb, stuck him in a borrowed tomb. That's what they did to Jesus. He said, if they are going to persecute me, they're going to persecute who? Us, right? We're going to be persecuted. And that's why we as Christians sometimes, we get messed up. We get all messed up. I thought I was supposed to, when I became a Christian, people are going to really like me. Not always. Not always. The world's not going to really like what you have to say necessarily. So you just have to deal with it. And you know, I think the same thing's true about God. I think what we do is, in the same way we want our God, we want to fit in. We want the God that we serve to fit in. We want to be liked. We want our church to be liked. We want our pastor to be liked. Good luck with that. And we want our God to be liked, don't we? Yeah, we want our God to, we want him to be liked too. And you know what? That's what happens. And so what we'll do is we'll take an image of God. And we camp out only on one angle of God. See that? Let me give you an example. Today, the catchphrase for God is love, right? Is that true? Absolutely it is. The Bible says it. That's scripture. That's biblical. God is love. But is that supposed to be comprehensive? I mean, it's true, but is it comprehensive of God? And I would say, no, it's not comprehensive of God. It's not all God is. Well, God's all about love. No, God's about a lot of other things other than love. Love is just part of it. You know, love drove Jesus to give his life on the cross, but love was the motivation. But God's obedience was the activity. So there's more to it than that. But you know what I tend to find? Is we tend to camp out on the one particular area or our angle on God where we benefit the most. If we don't feel loved, we feel marginalized or isolated or not a part of the pack or something like that, we love to camp out on God as love. The way I see God, he's all about love, and that's all you'll talk about, and that's the only thing you see. But let's say, for instance, if you didn't feel accepted and you feel rejected and you feel like you've done some stuff in your past, you've messed some stuff up, you slept with some people you shouldn't, and you did some things you shouldn't have done, you saw some things, hurt some people. You know what? You want to camp out on God's grace. God's all about grace. Is God about grace? Absolutely. The Bible says Jesus is full of grace and truth. Yeah, grace. If you're somebody who wants to control other people and get people for behaving badly, you're all about God's justice. God is just. He's going to punish you. Talk about things like hell, and it's coming your way. God's going to get you. All you other bad people, like a whack-a-mole, they can't wait to get you on this planet. You camp out there. Is that comprehensive? No. See, here's the problem. Our problem is we only want to see God from our perspective, and we don't want to see God for how he projects himself. Now, let me give you an example. God is love. Love, 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 love. That's, it's everywhere. Love, love, love. I like love. I like the love of God. Is the love of God important? Absolutely. But that's not all God's about. Let me give you an example. Okay, let's say, for instance, you're going to Niagara Falls. Let's say you got this rich cousin that can't go to Niagara Falls, but has always wanted to go to Niagara Falls, and they're going to send you to Niagara Falls. And it's going to be like this incredible vacation, all expenses paid, a jet boat tour up the river at Niagara Falls. I don't even know what the river is. Maybe it's Niagara River. Maybe it is. I don't know. Anyway, you're going to jet around there, and you're going to get to see the water, and you're going to get this real picturesque, you know, personal tour, and your wealthy cousin's going to send you there. And here's what your cousin says, but here's what I want you to do. I want you to explain to me Niagara Falls. Don't send me any pictures. I don't want to see a Facebook post. I want you to go see Niagara Falls, and I want you to explain to me Niagara Falls in one word. One word. That's all. Now, just think about it for a second, and I want you guys to help me here. What's the one word you would use to describe Niagara Falls? If you could only use one word, what one word would you use? Majestic. Okay, majestic. That's a good word. Majestic. Okay, Niagara Falls is majestic. All right? So I get up in the morning, and Channel 2's playing, and remember the soft-spoken guy that used to paint on Channel 2, whatever his name was, used to paint the happy squirrels? He's painting something. He says, this is a majestic painting. So does that mean I'm at Niagara Falls now? Does that mean that that's what Niagara Falls? Or I see my wife, and she comes out, and she's always beautiful, and I go, honey, you are majestic. Does that mean my wife looks like Niagara Falls? Does that mean that she's Niagara Falls? No. Or how about this? What if you'd use the word wet? Niagara Falls is wet. Does that mean when I take a bath, it's like Niagara Falls? Does that mean that when someone shoots me with a water gun or water pistol, that's Niagara Falls? Does it mean when we go swimming in a swimming pool? Does it mean when it rains, is that Niagara Falls? Do you see how hard it is? Now think about it. You go, well, Scott, that's silly to try to describe Niagara Falls in one word. That's ridiculous, man. Why would you try? You're trying to describe an infinite God with a finite language, and you're going to boil it down to one word? And as big as the word love is, and it's an incredible word, don't get me wrong, it's incredible, but I got news for you. To try to put God in the Tupperware container of a single word will not work. He's infinitely bigger. If that was all there is to this book, then was the rest of this filler? Well, is this rest of this stuff just they didn't have anything better to do, so we'll put a whole bunch of other stories in there, but really the only thing that matters is love. Well, wait a second, there's other things in here like justice and honor and glory, and worship, and service, and prayer, and obedience. There's a whole bunch of stuff in here. But that's where we are with God. We tend to pick out the attributes of God that is the most fitting, or that we like the best, and that's the only one we want to focus on. But he's more than that. Do you understand? Well, let me tell you why I'm focused on God so much, is because you'll never know your identity, the divergent identity that God has given. You'll never know it until you drill into the identity of who God is. Because he is the one who defines who you are, and you have to know him. And he's very divergent because he's incredibly intelligent. He's amazingly brave. He is honest and selfless and so forth. He's all of that. And he's called you to be the same. He really has. So we have a desire to please people. That's why we're not diverging, and we can't handle criticism is a second reason. So if we're going to diverge, what are some of the things that we have to do? Let me give you a couple things real quick. Number one is we have to begin thinking divergently. Stop letting someone else tell you how to think. Stop that. Stop letting someone else determine your thought. Stop letting someone get you upset about something that's not even your problem. Stop letting someone pick a fight that's not even your fight. Start thinking divergently. Let me give you an example. Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, don't live any longer the ways of this world, but let your thinking be completely changed. The world has a particular way that it wants you to live. You got to stop living by that way. Stop letting the world dictate your life. You have a Savior and a Lord and a God who's called you on purpose to be on mission for him. You need to start thinking from his perspective and stop thinking from the world's perspective. And you know the only way that you can do that is if you spend more time in his word than you do the words of the world. You've got to limit the influence of one, and you have to maximize the influence of the other. That's the only way that you can do it. Don't live any longer the ways of this world. Let your way of thinking be completely changed. Then you'll be able to test what God wants you to do. Then you're going to know what he wants you to do. It's going to come clear to you. More than that, then you'll agree that what he wants is right. In other words, there's a way that you can live, and God's thinking that's not like your thinking will begin to make sense to you. When you tap into Him, when you're fellowshipping with Him, when you're communing with Him, you'll learn to trust Him. You know what? God, I wouldn't do it this way, but I trust You because You are God, because I know You love me. You don't. You always follow through. You never leave me. Romans 12 said there's a way that you can live. There's a way that you can live that the thinking that God has that's different from yours will still, it'll start to make sense to you. And all of a sudden you'll go, wow, you know what? What God's asking me to do, that makes sense, God. And it's a good thing. I see following You is actually a good thing. But the longer you stay embedded in the world, the more God's word is going to seem foolish to you. Let me give you a few examples. Some ways of divergently thinking. These aren't comprehensive. They're just a few ideas that I had. How about this? You need to learn how to stay focused and distract in a distracted time. Would you say we're distracted? Crazy distracted. I'm a follower of Jesus. I don't have time for every cause that comes along. I'm going to make some of you mad right quick, okay? So just plan on going to another church after I say this. You don't have time for rainbows and rebel flags. Just pause for a second. Listen to me. You don't have time for that. The hope of the world is in Jesus alone. And it comes through the preaching of the gospel. Let me tell you something. You can get out there and you can win all the arguments you want to win about this or that. But let me just tell you something. What needs to be won is the lost of our community. God did not send you to be an attorney or an arguer or an activist. He sent you to preach the gospel to all people, regardless of race, creed, or color, because we are one family. We are to love people. But listen to me. The way we love people is we present the gospel. You don't have time. You know what? You can tell me the last 27 arguments you made about some silly flag that don't matter, but you can't tell me the last time you led somebody to Jesus. There's something wrong with your journey. And I want to be clear, I'm not chiming in so that I'm a part of this, whatever this stuff that's going on. That stuff is ridiculous. We don't have time for that. You don't have time for that. You don't have time to take up some kind of banner. You don't have time for that. Preach the gospel. Share Christ. The one thing that's really important in this world that's lost is souls. That's what you've been sent for. You only have a few days. Do you know how many times I'm at the hospital with people who had no idea they were about to die? I've been a pastor 20 plus years. I've been by the bedside of tons of people who they had plans for this week. They had ideas. They had a to-do list they were working on. And today, they are gone. You don't have time to waste your life on anything. You only have time to be on mission and on Christ's purpose. That's it. It's the most important thing. You want to help our community? Love people. Share the gospel with them. Tell them about Jesus. Let me go back to South Carolina for a second. South Carolina, in a primary African-American church, has probably given us the, and it's crazy to me that we've yet to even hardly pay attention to it, has given the greatest demonstration of how we're supposed to live. It's changed my life. A guy stands in front of a camera, stoic. He's yet to ask for forgiveness. He's probably crazy, or maybe he's just mean. I don't know what he is. I can't judge his heart, but I'll tell you, he stands before a camera emotionless. He's yet to own anything that he's done. He murdered 9 people. 9 good people died. And he stands in front of a camera. And 9 representatives of those families stood and said, "I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. You hurt us, but I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you." That's how we're supposed to live. You want to do something for race relations? You want to do something for community? You want to talk about bringing people together? You want to talk about making a significant contribution to our culture and our community and our country? Live the gospel. changes everything. No riots in South Carolina. No hatred. Because 9 families courageously stood up and said, we're going to be Jesus. Changes everything. That's what we have a chance to do. We have to start thinking differently. We have to stop thinking the way the world's thinking. You can win the argument and lose the war. You can win the campaign that you're on. And in the end, what do you have? What do you have? I don't know. Certainly not what we were sent for. But then we also have to live divergently. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 and 12 says this, "Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day that he visits." You know how we live divergently? I'm going to just give you a simple plan. You need to go back. If you know Christ as your Savior, you need to go back and you need to consider what you were saved from. You spend some time there. In fact, you need to constantly go back and rerun the tape of what you've been saved from. See, a changed life on this side is a life that recognizes what it's been saved from. There was an instance in Jesus' life where there was this pitiful lady that she was sinful, and everybody's like, that's no good, rotten, da-da-da-da. And Jesus forgives. And there's this group of religious people that didn't think they really needed Jesus' forgiveness. They're like, what's he talking about? And Jesus gives this teaching. He says this, you know what? He said, those who are forgiven of much, they're the ones that are the most grateful. And I think for us, many times in our life, we don't realize what we've been forgiven of. We don't realize the acceptance that God has given us. We don't realize the love that God has shown us. We don't realize the penalty and the price that God paid for us. We don't really realize that. And because we don't spend time with that, because most of us think we're pretty good. I'm a pretty good person. I'm just a little rough around the edges. So Jesus didn't die because you were rough around the edges. He died because you were rotten and hell-bound. He died because there's nothing good in you. He died because that you couldn't possibly be made right with God without him. You need to consider what you've been saved from. When you consider that and it somehow saturates and marinates your soul, all of a sudden you start living differently. Forgiveness isn't hard when you recognize how much you've been forgiven of. Love isn't hard when you recognize how much you've been loved. Grace isn't hard to give away when you realize how much grace was given to you. We've got to change the way we live, but we have to go back to what we've been saved from and spend enough time there that we realize, you know what? I wasn't just a good person, and God came along and said, hey, you know, I'm going to help you with this one little thing, and then you can go to heaven. We were separated from God, eternally hell-bound. And God came, and it wasn't a small payment. He gave his son for us. Died in our place. It reminds me of this lady that was on one of those reality shows, and she'd been in a car wreck, and it was just unbelievable that she was alive. She's like tooling down the interstate, and something happened, and I don't really remember exactly, but the car starts rolling, and when it does, the lady don't have her seatbelt on, and she shoots out the window like a rocket. And I'm like, oh my, worst thing I've ever seen. And when she hits the ground, it just mangles her. She just balls up. Just a wad. That person's dead. And I mean, if it wasn't for the fact that she was sitting there in the studio talking about this deal, you would have thought that lady's dead. She'll never walk again if she were to live, but there's no way. She's just a little wad of flesh. That's it. But what was funny is the guy that was talking asked her, he said, what were you thinking when this happened? She said, only thing I remember is getting on the interstate, and I don't remember anything that happened after that. I think that's how it is sometimes with us. You remember maybe getting into relationship with God, but you don't really think about what happened to you. As this lady was watching this video of her, she was having revelation. She said, oh my gosh, that's hard for me to believe. I'm still alive. And she was the one going through it. But as she continued to watch that tape, her eyes were opened to how fortunate she was, what kind of miracle it was. Listen to me. The more you go back and recognize what you've been saved from and get honest with it, the more you'll realize how good God is. Romans chapter 2, verse 4 said, it is the goodness of God that brings about repentance in our life. You want to live differently? Go back and consider how good God has been to you. And out of that, God will bring about repentance, His goodness. That's been really good to me. Really good. It's been really good to you too. We need to live divergently. And then we need to become dauntlessly divergent. How do we do that? And I think we need to keep in mind is that we only need to please God. We really only need to please God. I'm going to read one verse to you, and we're going to get out of here. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, it says, "For we speak as messengers." We speak as messengers. Everybody's going to help me here. So we speak as messengers what? So does that mean we're currently approved or we're still waiting for approval? Yeah, we're already approved, right? We're reading it, you know. It says, "For we speak as messengers approved by God." That means we're already approved. Listen to what he says, approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Why have you been approved to be entrusted with the good news? Because you're the product of the good news. You're the pudding. And you're the proof of God's work. It's your life. God says, you know what? You've been approved to tell the world about how good I am. You've been approved to carry my image into the world. You've been approved to live divergently, to be like me, to be a reflector that reveals me. You've been approved. You want to know why? Because your life change is a testimony. It's a story that I want the world to know. You're an approved messenger. We don't share the gospel to be approved. We're already approved. You're not earning your way into heaven. You've already been given, granted, permission to heaven. All the more reason to live for God. For we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Our purpose is to please who? Not who. I tell my kids all the time, you know, because there's times they go through seasons, you know, where something's going on at school and somebody's talking about somebody or whatever. And I just tell them, because we adults know. I tell them, I said, look, as soon as you graduate, you'll probably never see those people again. So don't worry about it. I mean, they're just there for a little bit, right? I mean, you see a handful of people you graduated with, maybe. You know? I mean, you're not going to see them again, so why are you worried about their opinion? Why are you concerned about what they're saying? Just let it go. Don't worry about it. Whose opinion really matters? I tell people all the time, you know why I go on vacation a long way from here? Because I want to take my shirt off. And I want to make sure if I take my shirt off, I'll never have to see those people again that saw me with my shirt off. Right? I don't ever want to look at them in the face again. There was this lady who used to go to church with us. She had this thing that it was an exercise thing that she had a clinic. I mean, you put on these, strap on these deals, and she said, man, it's like doing 1,000 setups and da da da. I didn't really listen to it real good. I thought, easy, 1,000 setups and six pack abs or whatever you're saying. I thought, hey, let's try it. I'm going to do it. So I didn't realize they're shocking you when you get, it's a shock thing. I'm like, 1,000 setups seems easy after you've been hooked to the electric chair. And so we get over there, and she's like, yeah, you got to strip down to your underwear. Now, this is a girl I go to church with. I was like, that ain't happening. That's just not going to happen. I said, what else can we do? You got a plan B? She's like, well, you know, you just have to. I was like, well, forget it. I got to find another diet plan because that ain't going to work. Because I'll have to see you again, and then I have to relive what I think you're thinking when you look at me again, and I don't want to feel that way about myself. But when you don't think you're going to see this person ever again, let me just give newsflash to all of us. You know what? There's opinions that are shared about you right now. There's ideas and expectations you're trying to live up to right now that, listen to me, ain't going to matter a year from now. You're sacrificing your life right now for people that it won't even matter what they think about you. They don't know you, and they don't know you. Only God's opinion is eternal. So what are you living for? You living for the opinion of this temporary idea about you? Are you living for God's opinion about you? Does your life look like the world, or does it look like Jesus? Which is it? It's a big deal. It is. I want you to bow your heads with me just for a moment. Just don't look around for just a second. Consider this one more time. Consider this. Does your life look like the world? Does your opinions look like the world? Or does it look like Jesus? Do your words look like the world? Or do they look like Jesus? Do you look like you're religious? Does your life look religious, or do you look like Jesus? Does your life look like it walked out of the Bible? Or does it look like you walked out of the Bible Belt? God has called you to be divergent. He's called you to know Him. He's called you to be a reflection of Him, that others might see Jesus in you. And when you don't live that out, when your light does not shine, there's a darkness. There's a darkness that could be extinguished if you simply took seriously this moment in time to live and look like Jesus, some of you right now, really for the very first time, you're recognizing that you need to put your life in God's hands. It's time to surrender. It's time to experience the salvation that I've been talking about. See, you are separated from God. The loneliness that you're experiencing, the guilt, the distance that you're experiencing between you and God is because you are separated from God. Your sin has bolted the door shut, but God desires to come in. God will not knock down the door. He will not force himself upon you, but God is today knocking. He's asking to come in. I want to remind you that 2,000 years ago, God knew the worst of you even before you were born. And the worst of you fell upon God's Son. And at the cross of Calvary, Jesus was crushed because of my sin and because of your sin. He died for you. And at that moment, your sin went away. And the forgiveness that God is offering, he's offering that to you today. Your whole life, he's been just waiting for you to take it. And this is your moment, this is your time to accept God's forgiveness, to open the door, to experience a relationship with God. It's time for you to do that. Let me lead you in a prayer. If you're ready for that, let me just speak, and you and I will pray together. You just silently, you're going to speak to God. I'll help you with the words. And God will enter your life and you'll never be the same. The guilt will go away. The clarity of the gospel will be clear to you. Forgiveness will be yours. A future will be yours. A father will be yours. If you're ready for that, why don't you pray with me? Just a simple prayer, just silently where you are. Just pray with me. Something like this. Just say this. Say, Lord, I realize how I need you today. Thank you for offering me salvation. God, I receive that. I receive the forgiveness that you're offering me. I receive this new life that you're offering me. And God, I know it is because of your death where you took my place and my punishment on the cross that this is possible. Lord Jesus, I give my life to you. In the days to come, teach me how to live. Thank you for loving me, Jesus. I offer this prayer and I give you thanks. It is in Christ's name I pray. Amen.